Should we have a discussion around Android and open source? So how many of you are have looked at Android or the code or something like that, tried a Git repo or something, or tried custom ROMs or something like that? So I guess most of you are not aware of custom ROMs and Android. Aware? Right. I haven't tried it. So what makes custom ROMs possible?
Open source, having the ability, having access to the main code repo, so that one can fork and modify to their, customize the look and feel or the functionality to a great extent because it is open. I use a custom ROM called Paranoid Android on my Nexus 4. I use it because it allows me to change a lot of things. Like I get more space on my Nexus 4. Normally when people see my Nexus 4, they see that has a bigger display. but the reality is I make the navigation bar smaller, and to get more space, I change color settings and stuff like that. So anything from sound control to display alphas, everything, I change a lot of things here and there to suit me. So
one thing is the code is accessible, yeah. Right? But do you think all the code that is required to run on your phone is accessible to you?
I don't think so. Something
related to ODEX and DODEX. Something related to DODEX and ODEX. ODEXing and DODEXing.
No.
No.
The reason for that is, sorry.
The binary, blobs from the vendors themselves to access the hardware might be or might not be open, so they will not release it. In case of Samsung with their Exynos chipset, they did not release the code. So
yeah, similar issue I faced in my last phone. This is a Nexus and hence there's everything available. So the last one, some ROMs used to, screw up the radio. They did not have drivers for GPRS to work, Wi-Fi to work, stuff like that. So
does it answer the question if Android is open source or not? Or does it make you more confused?
What is the line between what is Android and what is the vendor, what he provides? Is it
what do you define Android as? Come on.
It's a platform, basically, an OS. So I don't know if it's part of the OS or...
See, if the OS is there and it doesn't run on your phone, it's not an OS.
Yeah.
Right. It's as simple as that. Or what do you think otherwise?
I don't know. It's like Android must be like 2.5. Like we are talking about the basic system, the UI are we talking, or we are talking about just like the plain Android? Like what exactly are we talking about?
What do you mean by plain Android?
It's like plain Android and we have a UI on top of it, right? So it's like you buy a Samsung phone or something, like we have some apps or something made on Android, so like apps... Like
it's not a classic concept.
So it's like apps, obviously they are ODEX, right? So you have some part of it and the other main program, right? So you cannot directly modify the apps or like say a ROM. Like some ROMs are ODEX, so you just cannot customize the stuff there. Like you cannot tweak it, you have to first de-ODEX it, you have to get the ODEX
file. Wait. What we are talking about is open source or not, right? See, if you don't have the source code for it, it's not open source. Very clear, right?
Yeah.
So one thing is there that at the driver level, if I get to, if I can just compare with the desktop world, right? The drivers of various vendors, they are not really open.
Open source, right.
And why they are keeping it closed is, I have no idea. Probably it's a shitty code they don't want to show it probably. Because if there is something and it is available, anybody can decompile and run it. And that's what they're doing with most of the ROMs, right? A lot of devices are supported by that kind of a mechanism where you hack into it. It's not a straightforward way. It's a risky way that you anyways do it.
And you will probably end up violating some laws.
Your warranty is void. Definitely.
No, not warranty, because there is the vendor himself, vendor is not giving you the code of the drivers directly. So you are hacking into it, in different means to get offended, right? So
yeah, in India, I think we don't bother about that at all. So because here your device is your device, you can do whatever with you. So the only thing is they won't support you at all.
Yeah.
But the other question is, one is this side. The other side is, Google has its own apps, which, so if I put Android in a way, right, the Android APIs are open source. That's the only thing I can best describe Android as. I mean, because you have the top, bottom layer of the drivers, which may or may not be open source, for sure. But the middle layer is definitely open source. That's where you have all the APIs. If you talk about the UI, right, your home screen, everything. If you see a messaging app or contacts or the APIs which are there to build your own app, you can build your own contact in the home screen, right? All those APIs are pretty much open. You can just go ahead and replace it without any issues. So the problem is Google has its own apps now. And it has made them closed. It has kept them closed. For reason best known to them, the business reason or whatever. Now, it's okay, right? I mean, if somebody is giving their apps and keeping it closed source, not like making it open, it's fine, right? There's no issue with Android being not open source. Right? But now, come to think about Google Play.
Google?
Play.
Play, okay.
Google Play is closed source. You can't just get it.
Yeah.
If you are installing it on a custom ROM, you're kind of bordering on the gray areas. Google hasn't really fought on you on that, but it falls in the gray area because Google hasn't given you a license to use that. And guess what is there in Google Play now? Do you know anybody, Android developers? Any ideas?
What
is there in Google Play other than the purchase market app, market thing?
Movies,
books, yeah. From the developer APIs part.
Maps as well. Services?
Services. It has own services. So one important service that they have enclosed in is location. So do you think location belongs to Android or does it belong to Play Store?
Belongs to GS package, which contains all the Google.
So, let me confuse you here. So, you can't access location APIs on Android without
using Play.
Without having Play.
No.
Is that right?
Well, this is not right. What I said was wrong. So, what they've done is you have very core level APIs to access the drivers. They are in Android. But they have built a lot of technologies on top of it, which simplifies. So basically, if you have to use the core level APIs for getting your location, it's a pain in the ass. There will be N providers. You don't know which one is best. To figure out the best one, also you will have your own share of issues. Then how granular you can be, that also is a questionable thing. And plus, what does this mean is you are kind of repeating the code again and again. So Google did a smart thing now. He said, we'll bundle it as a Google Play services. This was then the last IO. So they released it as a Google Play service. So this thing is supposed to be very smart. So it will have your location and it will be able to, your apps need not have a complicated logic to understand or not take 10 minutes to understand where you are, all those things. So they are doing it on the back end, they are already tracking you. So basically they know where you are already. So they can tell you very easily. So they launched it as a service. The killer part of the service is it's in Play. Your Play app was some under 10 MB before Google I/O, and after Google I/O, it's more than 20 MB. Hello, I had a Nexus One, which was running at a razor thin margin of 20 MB. So after that update, it stopped working. So that's how I know it's the size is that much. That's the only way. Then I realized, okay, this is what they've done, and figured it out. So Google Play APIs. So as a developer, what will you do? Will you use the Android APIs, or will you use the Google Play Services APIs, which are free for you to use and track your?
Eventually, developers will opt for the easier option, which is Play.
Eventually or initially? I am lazy. I would use that.
I mean, it's the go-to option, obviously. Google has made it look like that anyway.
So right.
They are cleanly channeling you to use it. So
they're the gold standard.
Yeah.
So now you're in an infinite loop of getting stuck with Google. If you don't have Google, if your customer does. So earlier you could sell your apps or ask them to download from any of the app stores. Now if the user doesn't have Google Play, you don't get the location. And that is fine with 90% of our developers, I believe. Think about it. Would it be good for you, okay with you if it's only on the app store? What do you say? Have you downloaded apps from any place other than Google Play Store?
Yeah, directly from GetJar.
Show of hands, how many have used App Store other than Google Play?
Not from the App Store, directly from the APIs.
Direct download of the APIs.
But were you taking from an App Store or from the developer directly? I just want to.
Developer directly, most.
Or pirated.
Our own app.
Yeah. So the deal here is, now if you get into that mode, developer can never sell an Android app on
different
Play Store. App stores at all. I mean, you have to have Play Store installed on the phone, which is not guaranteed if you are not downloading from Play Store. May or may not be. I mean, I have seen some of the Chinese devices which don't have Play Store. They have GetJar. And Kindle Fire is the perfect example, which has its own. So if you're even thinking up, as an app developer, you're even thinking about going to other app stores, and if you're using any of the Google Play APIs, basically forget it. So now let's get back to the question of being open source.
Is open source. I don't see it at all.
So, now with this perspective, and like Google is saying, Google is Android, Android is Google, right? And that's what generally comes. But when they have inserted this another layer. Okay, before that, let's think about why did they have to do that?
I think
So, most of the services earlier had to be done for different devices. Now, once they are part of different APIs, which are being developed by Google itself, so that takes away the challenge for different Samsung or these kind of companies to basically work on those. So, in a way, it does address fragmentation issue.
Yeah.
Because if you see in the last I/O, most of the services that they have launched, they are distributed to 90 to 95% of the users who don't have the updated OS, in the sense that latest 4.something. Even people who are using on 2.3, they are able to access those kind of services. So
yep.
From a user perspective, you see, it's a big advantage.
So, they could have done it with the entire OS layer also, right?
Yeah. Why did they have to do it on the
based. So that's what he's saying, because the carriers themselves do not push an update. They just stop after a while. Probably Samsung has stopped.
No, if Google could do it in Play Services API, they might have as well included it in the Android API itself. That is the question.
How do you push it to the users there?
No, why in the Play? They could have made an open application and said, okay, download this from wherever you want and have it there. They didn't do that.
If they had options, it's Google
they're talking. Hey, you want to provide an API which you want everybody to use? Awesome.
I think the agenda is to control the market.
Yeah. So it's more like, I think it's more about the control. I do think like that. Rather than, user is like a small part of that whole equation rather than, or maybe the other way around also. Okay. Kill two birds in one stone. So, so now coming to this Play Store not being open, right? Now, let's talk about what it has. I mean, it has one location. Second, it has push notifications. Third, it has those APIs for game development, basically for communication between users and their devices. All the cool demos that I don't know if you seen that cool demo of the games?
Yeah.
So they had three different size devices put, and three different people playing the same game where they were pushing the same item again here and there. So all connected and playing together. Multiplayer game.
Real-time multiplayer game.
So that was cool. So that is a premium service, definitely, right? But is location a thing like a GCM is a premium service? Where they should, I mean, obviously, it requires a lot of infrastructure and a lot of security in the back end. But is location that much secure? I think location was just the first step which they could easily put in. And with a statement like, you're getting as good service as a Google Maps is their pitch, right, for using this API. I sometimes wonder if this is actually the route. So what do you think we can do about it now?
Is there any alternative to using, suppose I don't want to use location API, so is there any alternative available?
So now that's the second part of the question, right? Wait, what is the alternative to using a Google Play service? So the alternative is to build a parallel service. So keeping those things in mind, I was planning to start a working on this library. So I don't know how bad it is. So that is the location thing is what was intriguing me. The other things like GCM, a push notification server, I don't think so. It's a rocket science that only Google can build it and no one else. It's just about how people can.
It's basically a push. GCM is basically authenticating things. Like you are authenticating devices and you are sending it to that particular device which has been registered.
No, there's no authentication there. The thing there is
you register a key to Google server, it will take your IMEI number of the device and then register the saves a copy over there in their cloud. And then when they are sending a message to this kind of a key or something, it will verify which device it is and then it will send it only to that. That's how GCM works.
So the way GCM works, what I remember is, it generates an ID, it's not the IMEI number, it generates an ID.
Okay.
So for each other device, you have to ping to the Google Play service, ask them for their ID, and that gets stored in the server. That's, you need to save it in your application or on the server, wherever you are. You'd be saving it on your server. So when you save it on the server, then when you have to push a message to it, you tell Google server, this is my API key, I am this guy, and I want to send message to this particular guy. So those are the keys.
There are two keys, right? One is a device key and then the user login. User has to allow that notification.
No. There's nothing like that.
So Apple notification works.
Yeah, because
not on Android. That's why you if you use the Barcamp Bangalore Android app, you don't get asked anything there. You'll just happily get the messages whatever you are sending. So this was one thing I was trying when I was looking for other implementation for push notification. The funny part is there are alternatives available, but the thing is they're hardly used.
One thing probably the GCM is the infrastructure which they have to process millions of messages, because the way messages are sent, they are instantly delivered to thousands of devices. I don't know how hard or easy it will be to replicate that. I mean, a library you can provide software for the phone, but counting on the other side, there are servers and everything which are managing those queues, and if the device is off, it will keep it there and send it in the next 3 days and all those things. That might be slightly, which makes it non-open source in the sense.
Why would that be a non-open source?
The open source is wrong, but basically it takes, you cannot provide it just like that by an open source library, because you actually need a lot of infrastructure, hardware infrastructure.
So there are a lot of alternatives for push notification. Okay. That is there. It's not that you are bound to that. But when you could talk, get into location, get into sticky wicket. There are libraries available.
Yeah,
which is but the problem with those libraries is the same, which is there with using writing your own code and using the APIs. You can, one thing, it takes data and basically it will keep, it will have to pull the various sensors on your device to get it going. You can't just do it on the fly. So what Google Play, where the Google Play location service is really adding value, so it caches those values over there. So what the only replacement is not a library, but a service which keeps running and which pulls data very effectively. A library will kind of be, I would say, you won't get any major advantage over any of the services. So that's what I've started looking into. So if anybody wants to join me in with that, I'll be happy to have a discussion with you guys and we can do it together also. So I think I'm ending my session quite fast.
Can you just describe how have you begun or how are you planning to begin?
The service part?
Yes.
So here's the thing. A Google Play, you have to have an APK to run a service, which should be common. So the idea right now that I have in my mind is have a APK which is available any for anybody to download. And whenever an app wants to start using that Play service, it can go ahead and download that APK and get it set up. If the APK is already there, it may skip that step and directly connect with the service which is running there and get the location values directly instead of getting to the root of where you are dependent on somebody else who's no clue whether it works or not. So if the user says, no, I don't want to download, then you can actually say, okay, this is necessary for you to use the location service.
What is the future of this? Why would anybody want to not use what Google is providing and have his own setup? It's like having an alternative path.
That's why I started with, do you have your apps on it? Do you download apps from a Play Store other than Google Play?
From Play Store apps? Yeah.
From any Android apps from any place other than Play Store. That's what I asked. A lot of people
that
do.
That is the purpose. Like if you want to distribute your app
on other places,
you want to make it available for a download. Say for example, Blue Shark. it is not allowed on the Play Store. What do they do? Like, so you can only download it through their official website. It's not available on the Play Store. So what happen, what if Google decides to ban your app? What will you do? So you will have to find your own ways of distributing it. So if you want to distribute it, then if you are, if you have used Play APIs, then you are stuck with it. You cannot distribute through other channels.
That's where the power of Android actually lies. That you're not dependent on Google at all. But they're trying to make it go the Apple way, where you are dependent on everything for Apple. If Apple says no, you're pretty much out of the door.
But suppose, let's say, in future, this kind of a library comes into place, don't you think this will be restricted by Google as well? Something like how Apple pushes.
There's no reason for app, for Google to restrict it. I mean, we are not using any APIs which is banned by Google. We are just making sure we are running another service which can give you some benefit.
Yeah, true, but in the sense they themselves are forcing you to channelize
their... So that will be blatant violation, right? I'm sure Apple can do that or Microsoft can do that, but Google, I think, would stay away from that kind of controversy. You can do that. You can download other apps and get them installed also.
No, I'll install one app through which I'll have my own app service. I can do that.
You can do that. You have to write that. That's exactly my aim with the location service. Because the way I'm seeing, probably next. They were just testing the ground with this first piece of Google location APIs. I think they're going to go much deeper into that. There are a lot of stuff which is complex right now in Android, and which Google is good at. Like, right now they use intent to send mails. And authentication also, like Google authentication, they have the OAuth set up completely. They might very well do away with that and say only Play. There is a Play authenticator.
But what I was interested in is how not to use the Gmail ID when I use Android. We didn't talk about that.
You can very well use, so that's another thing. If you use, if you're not logging into Play services, you'll probably not be able to download the apps. If you're not downloading the apps, and you're downloading it from somewhere else, then you can't really use these Play services. Because they don't know, I mean, if you're distributing by a channel other than Google Play Store, there's no guarantee that that Play service will be available on the device. And somebody who downloads from the store other than the Google Play Store, 99% of the time, that guy will not have, 90% of the time, that guy will not have access to Play. Because most of them will have some Chinese apps, Chinese phones, which have no. Even Amazon, like Kindle Fire, will not have Play Store. You can't even set that up on it. That, I think. I don't know if Google has blocked or Amazon blocked. Somebody has blocked. Same goes with a lot of tablets, actually. I don't know why everybody is doing that with tablets, but they're doing it.
Second, I flashed Amazon mod on my Kindle Fire. Could not live with it.
So how do you take care of data then, in that case? If you are coming up with this service, what is the one defective standard that we are following, that okay, we are not fiddling around with any data, any user data? How you are making sure?
So, let me put it this way. So, what data is will the service access?
Okay. So, first is like the context.
It will access only the location.
Okay.
It will not access what you're logged in as or what your username is, what apps you have and all that. It will access only the location.
Mm-hmm.
And the app which has to access that location, it will be telling like, okay, location is being accessed. That too would need the permission, right? So that's how it will be kind of permissions are taken care of.
Basically, the library will only give you how to access
it. It will not be a normal library in the sense that we think of. What I'm thinking of is more on the lines of a service, which is a, will be an APK. So when you first time kind of start this off, you'll first check whether that app has, that device has that APK or not. If it doesn't have, you'll have to pull that down and install before you can start off.
This has not been done by anyone. No one has started this before you. Have you checked?
I haven't seen anybody do that.
Like CyanogenMod itself, they do. Maybe someone has started
that. CyanogenMod, I don't know if they have started. They don't really start
the analysis project with Focal coming in. The Focal camera. I don't know if people know of it. Should be there. So they started this project where, you know, you can get HDR on any mobile regardless of which camera you are using, because they will build it for you.
So HDR, like, for HDR, yes. Actually, there are different applications which are already available.
Yeah, but this is open.
They're making it open.
So there's this Free Android or something. It's an organization, no? Free Android. A group of people, yeah.
So that's why I haven't seen anybody build or even talk about it. That's why I thought. Okay. Yes. Thanks if anybody is interested. Thank you.